People deserve change, and therefore we as the side proposition support change. What I would like to show you through my three substantive points is that a book that we support political change through three substantive points. First, we're going to show you why we support an democratic regime. Second, I'm going to show you why we support an authoritarian regime. And my second speaker is going to talk about the right to protest. So what is street power? Street power are public demonstrations. We define street power as public demonstrations which are intended to severely affect the functionality of the state and its institutions. So why do we support it in democracies? We support it because the system of checks and balances doesn't always work, and therefore street power is the only way to change and or control the state. And why doesn't this system always work? First, because often in the Western world, especially in Europe, the system chooses itself. In the EU, the legislative branch of the government chooses the judicial branch of the government. What does this mean? That means that the judicial government is directly influenced by the legislation it is intended to control. And you're not going to control the people who give you your job. And that is why we believe that not always this system works. Yes, please.
Child labor laws, food safety laws, and civil rights laws were all passed through this legislative system.
Well, we believe that sometimes it doesn't work, it doesn't work always, and then, when the system doesn't work, we need street power. We see some example of Italy, where Berlusconi was a prime minister, we knew of his connection with the mafia, we knew of his sex crime, we knew of everything, but the government was so far under his control that the government did not intervene. The state organizations did not intervene until we protest, until we show to the government, until we show to the people that he does not deserve to be in power and that he should be removed. Not to mention the corruption in Spain, the corruption in Greece, which is already being protesting against because the government is not doing enough. And the government doesn't want to solve this problem. And this is why we need to be in power. Secondly, the system is often too slow because it takes a long time for the next elections to come, during which your government, which is doing bad things, can do a lot of damage. Especially during this time of crisis, we need to be able to change our governments quickly. Because if we have a bad government with bad economic policies, it is only going to drive us deeper into crisis. It is going to make more problems, which is going to make it more difficult to solve later. This is why we need to change it now. Also, it can make more deals, bad deals with the MMF, which cause later problems, which we have seen in Greece. And no government will agree to premature elections. We need to force the government to these elections, and we do it through street power. No thanks. This is seen in the example of the Orange Revolution, after which we saw the mobilizations, rigging of elections, there was believed rigging of elections of Yanukovych, and later on, the entire population of Kiev went to the streets, demanded change, they got a re-election, and the entire defendant won. And in this we see that street power can solve. So why does it solve the problem? Firstly, because they raise awareness about the problem. If you have 200,000 people on the streets, more people are going to see this problem. They're going to understand that, oh, they're protesting, something must be bad. And even though if we do not solve the problem immediately, on the next election, more people are going to understand the problem. More people are going to want to solve. And this we saw in the example of Hungary, where Orban wanted to introduce taxes on the internet. And the first protest wasn't so large. The second was larger. The third was so large that Orban decided to stop the taxes. Decided to stop the law. And this we see that protests caused a ripple effect, caused more people to engage. Not only this, but we see an example of Greece and Syriza, Spain and Poland, that street power creates an idea of an alternative. It created the idea of different organizations, of Syriza and Poland, which wanted change. It gave the people the idea of this, and now they are the strongest parties in these countries. Secondly, why does it solve? Because when the basic services of your country stop functioning, the state is so damaged and cannot function. Firstly, it's losing money. Secondly, it's not providing its citizens with enough care. And it has to be prepared to change their own actions and their own laws in order to stop this protest. This can be seen in the example of France, which wanted to privatize the train transport. It resulted in such a massive protest against this train transport that the entire railway system of France stopped working. And therefore, after this protest, they decided to stop with this legislation.
How can you list Ukraine, an example of a country that's still in a civil war, and Greece? elected a PM who refuses to work with the EU as success stories.
We do not say there are always success stories. And firstly, now we're talking about democracies and Western world. The idea of them, of authoritarian regimes are going to come to be marked by second point. And now, we have proven that the system isn't always functional and that therefore we need street power to control. And in the democracy, we understand that the system is not perfect. And we already recognize the right to protest, and we have. But now going on to the second part of authoritarian regimes. Because these are regimes which allow people no power. They use oppression of controlling the people. And there's absolutely no way to change this government except for using street power. Because no dictator and no strong president that has his military decides is going to leave his place willingly. He's going to use any means necessary. And people need to make the government so dysfunctional that it has to change. But not only this, it also provides a spotlight on the issue. It provides public scrutiny in the outside world on this issue. And this is seen on the example of the USSR resolution. Firstly, Prague Spring happened. They wanted the change of government, and the USSR sent a text. This did not bring to change, but the second time, when Solidarność started protesting in Gdańsk, the USSR was unable to stop. Bringing that because the scrutiny of the outside world and the entire world was so large that something, in, by doing so, setting in debt would result in even more protests throughout the entire USSR, which in the end brought to the dissolution of the worst communist regime in history. And in this, we see that they also are able to change authoritarian regimes. Only systemic application of street power can bring down authoritarian regimes because, firstly, it disables inner functionality. It disables the basic services. Secondly, it disables external functionality. Because before, it makes a spotlight on the problems in the outside world. And the outside world puts pressure on these countries to change. And they have changed, and we have seen it. And the only way for these systems to revert to democracy, where they don't need to protest, where they don't need to use street power, is to first use street power. We have seen this as an example of Arab Spring, which are now more democratic than before. Libya is not an example of this due to an outside intervention, but the countries of Morocco and Tunisia are now more democratic and have worked in doing this. And because street power enables change in two ways. Firstly, by using public scrutiny of the outside world on the authoritarian regime country, and secondly, by creating this functionality in such a large way that the government can no longer function and has to change, we believe we should support political change through street power. And it is often the only way to bring it up. And because we have shown that democracies do not always change in a sufficient manner for their people, that street power is necessary, is working, and is solving the problems, if not immediately, then by raising awareness and by raising it in the next elections, we beg you to propose. Thank you.
Secondly, we do not need the power. power that they suggested to create change. In a democracy, as they said, there are elections. There are laws that are passed by voters. There are things like the ability to impeach rulers. There are always checks on the system, and sometimes that system does get corrupted. But it doesn't mean that that corruption must be met by violence on the part of people in the streets, must be met by radical protests that shut down the entirety of societies. Those protests only work to hurt the very civilians who are trying to fight for change. Furthermore, what we heard is that they talked about how it's necessary to protest in this radical manner in order to bring any and all attention to these issues. But attention does not require actual protests in the way they say. Civil disobedience, social media movements, and legislation all draw positive attention to these matters because people can see that the people who protest are rational. They're trying to achieve a goal without endangering others or shutting down society. So we believe that their manner will only bring negative attention in the majority of cases. Furthermore, they then talked about Frank, but what we see, the problem is that when people refer to this radical type of protesting, that when you stop, then they stop the entirety of society, right? They talked about shutting down all transportation in France for a day. But we see that as inherently problematic because shutting down an entire society for the goals of a few is not going to lend you any support from the rest of that society. People are angry. Their welfare is being disrupted. Their ability to earn money is being disrupted, all because certain people have a goal that they believe merits them to override the needs of everyone else. We do not think this is acceptable. Now we heard their second point, which is basically that they support this type of change because in authoritarian regimes that are oppressive, the only way to create change is through these radical movements. So, firstly, we have a few different reasons why this fails. Number one, this doesn't work because it predicates change on violence. It teaches people that if you want to have new movements and if you want to rise to power, what you need to do is kill other people. You need to kill the people who you see as being in their way, which we will talk about later. But we do not believe that predicating change on violence, that saying that violence is necessary for change, is ever going to be okay or teach the right lesson. Secondly, we see that it fails because it moves international support away, which we will again further elaborate on. No international nation wants to go in and continue to support someone when they see that rebels are gunning down people who are soldiers, are letting people get caught in the crossfire. This doesn't work. Then finally, they mentioned the Arab Spring and how Morocco and Tunisia are so great and on balance this is what happens. No, these are outliers. On balance, what happens is nations like Syria, like Libya, like Egypt are left in shambles where civilians are killed in the crossfire. This does not work in this peaceful, idyllic way that they talk about. The loss of human life because of the reversion to violent protest is not acceptable and not to be
supported.
Now to move on to our own case. Our first point is that street power is inherently bad and fails. It is inherently bad because it requires a physical presence. So what we see is that there are moral and practical problems with this on the whole. So we cannot support it. Here's our moral problem. Physical presence just blocks society's progress on the whole. It often turns violent, and it puts people's lives in harm's way unnecessarily. And then the practical issue that we have with this is whether or not protest evolves into violence or is peaceful. It will always be bad and it will always fail. So here are two basic aspects of protests and why they are bad. The first is a peaceful protest. Here's our problem with it. It is too easy to suppress a group of people who all of a sudden come together and sit in one aspect of society. Now we saw this happen in Bahrain, where the government came in and killed every single peaceful protester in a matter of days. Now what we understood is that if people had reverted to this, if they had used the media, if they had used communication, if they had used language instead of putting themselves in harm's way, that actual protest could have survived. And this is the matter for many others. When people put themselves out there in such a way, they put themselves at risk, they put themselves in danger, and when they die, their ideas die. No thank you. So here's the second problem that we have with this. Is that often these protests will turn violent, which they're actually advocating for. Now we see this again and again when governments and protesters begin to clash. People can never maintain their legitimacy and the purity of their cause when they engage in fighting and exercising power. Because what ends up happening is that the civilians and the government become essentially one and the same. Each one kills the other to reach its goals, and neither one can actually advocate for peace when they're reverted to violence. Yes.
But when governments are repressive, the opposite happens. Protests in the USSR gain legitimacy when people started clashing with the government.
This is not true at all. Protesters actually lose their legitimacy. In the Arab Spring, many people, for example, in Syria, were supported by the international community until it all broke down with the violence, until we saw rebel factions and will ultimately fail. So we see that street power does not achieve political change that people want, but in fact does the opposite, because its very nature destroys the progress that people are seeking. So here's how the causes get destroyed. Firstly, when you protest in such a way, when you protest through street power, it turns people against the movement. We saw this with the Wall Street 1% movement in the United States. People become a nuisance, and although their grievances are absolutely legitimate, when they present themselves in such a way, society turns against them and squashes their voices. So we also see this as ineffective because it becomes scattered and disjointed. The Arab Spring was originally very coherent when people were communicating over social media, but when it devolved into violence and people went out and protested on the street, the messages that they were relaying became incoherent. No one was fighting for these same goals. It became confusing to everyone else, and it lost its power. Finally, we see that in the chaos, movements are co-opted by extremists, and this is one of the worst-case scenarios. And we've seen this especially in Syria and in Libya, that overall, the chaos that ensues from the use of street power and violence creates a chaotic land that is a perfect breeding ground for extremist groups to exert power and come in. Now, because we understand that every woman fighting for bodily autonomy, every child fighting for an end of war in their nation, and every person who has a legitimate grievance against their government deserves true progress, and because street power disrupts that progress, we are proud to oppose today's motion. Thank you.
Give the people a chance to see that there is an alternative. So we need quick scrutiny.
And they told us about how we have all these checks and balances in the world. But for example, even governments exist things such as lobbying, where there are 5 lobbyists, one representing in the US Congress, and there's so much money standing behind these people, sometimes we cannot be sure that the government is doing their job. And then we need to press them into being forced to change it. And sometimes, yes, we need to shut down society. An example of this is Macedonia and the student plenum. Now, what happened in Macedonia? The government wants to regulate the university system. All of the students in Macedonia are against this because universities cannot work with their governments regularly. So the students started protesting. Professors joined them, and there's a ripple effect. The entire educational system, it was shut down, and that's true. But that's a temporary shutdown for a long-term change, because the government of Macedonia decided not to implement a method that completely dysfunctionalized universities. So yes, we support temporary shutdowns for long-term change, because on the long-term, corrupt governments are much worse than the shutdown of a week or a month. Okay, secondly, concerning the point of violence, they say, and how sometimes these protests evolve to violence. Yes, it's true, but these protests evolve to violence in a case where you need to resist against someone. Often these violences begin when police start repressing people. And when you have a system where police repress people, and you can no longer turn even to the police, then you have no one left to turn to but yourself. Now, rebels gunning people down, this is not what we're talking about. These are not protests, these are wars, these are civil wars. Syria and Libya are in a state of perpetual conflict where rebel groups are being financed after military interventions. This is not street power, this is world at war in the Middle East. This does not work as an example. Now, what works as an example are the regimes such as for example Tunisia, which was democratized after the Arab Spring. Of course, this change is not perfect, but over time we can build a basis for change. We did not exist under the old regime. Another example of this is Yugoslavia. With the 1971, the Croatian Spring occurs. What did the Croatian Spring bring? The Croatian Spring forced Josip Broz Tito, the leader of Yugoslavia, to change the constitution as to give all the specific nations of Yugoslavia the right to secede from Yugoslavia. This would not have been able to people have not went to the streets, because Yugoslavia was an authoritarian regime which would not have changed if the entire educational system was not shut down. And even if there was some violence in the process, in the long term, this enabled Yugoslavian countries to gain the freedom they have today. So this violence brings long-term effects, and that's the reputation of their first point. It is true, just a moment. It's true that people sometimes put themselves in physical harm, but sometimes it is necessary. Before that, yes.
You say Syria doesn't count as terrible because it's in a state of civil war, but it wouldn't be in a state of civil war if protests hadn't turned violent.
Syria is in a state of civil war because states such as the United States of America are financing rebel groups and because ISIS has proclaimed the state on their sovereign territory. Okay, now concerning the point how people put themselves in harm's way. Yes, they do. But sometimes it's the only way. Jan Palach burned himself in Prague. He lost his life. But if it wasn't for Jan Palach burning himself, Solidarnosc would never have succeeded. Because it wouldn't have been public scrutiny on the USSR, which then became a moment to change his ways. Sometimes, if your regime will keep oppressing you, you need to put yourself at physical harm because it's the only way to change the situation. If you sit idly by, the regime will be oppressive for hundreds of years. If you put yourself at physical harm, yes, you take a risk, but A, you take that risk willingly so no one is forcing you, and B, you can change something. Let's turn to their second point, where they say that protests are lose legitimacy. That's completely untrue. It's completely untrue because we can show you for examples of Ukraine and elections, the reopening election of Yushchenko, through Hungary and France and Yugoslavia and Macedonia, the first actually gained legitimacy, and they did not destroy progress. They did not destroy progress because they only shut down society for a small amount of time, but they enable change on a long-term basis. So this is not shutting progress, enabling progress on the long-term change. What we're doing is untrue. Okay, now concerning our third substantive point. And what I believe, we believe that every single person has a fundamental right to protest. Now we believe that governments are institutions that are created just to cater to the needs of the people. And as long as this government is representing the people, we believe that the people should lead the government to do its job. Because yes, we let them to represent us. But since the government is a service towards the people, when the government starts being a service to itself, then the people have the full right to go onto the streets and reclaim this government. We never said that street power should be the first method being utilized. We do not say that the government says, oh, we do not agree that economic policy needs to change. The first thing we need to do is go on the streets and smash the windows. But what we do say is when the government does not react to systems of checks and balances, and there is no other way, such as an authoritarian regime, such as it was in Hungary, such as, for example, in Turkey, when protests started to protest for the sake of a public park, which they succeeded because there was no other way to persuade Erdogan to do this. We believe that it's legitimate and that every single person has the right to protest because every single person has a fundamental right guaranteed by the United Nations and the international community to have his interests listened to. This right to protest is mandated not only through social media but also through the right of stopping work and going on the streets recognized in most constitutions of the world. So what I've proven to you in my speech today? I've proven to you that the fact that checks and balances sometimes work does not mean they always work. And when they do not work, we need a quick change. I'll show you examples of Macedonia, the example of Spain and Greece, and in the first speech that this change happens and it's quick and it does create a ripple effect. I've shown that sometimes violence is necessary, and most often it's a response to state violence, because they themselves say that states often suppress peaceful protests. In states that suppress peaceful protests, there's no other way than to return to violence. There are no such alternatives, and because of that, every single person has a right to protest. Because of that right, I beg you to propose the motion. Thank you very much.
Injustice, and in response to oppression, it often seems very alluring to resort to destruction and to attack the system. I know the ballot box has less appeal than the sword, but in the vast majority of cases, it is far more effective to fight with your ideas and with your ballots rather than with your body and with your power. But it is more effective and more just to do what we're asking you to do. I'm asking you to support reasonable change over reactionism, to protect lives rather than thrown away through street power. That's what you should be voting for in this debate. So, first let's dismantle their case, and then let's go through our arguments. So, the first argument is about democratic regimes. They think it's more effective than there. The first thing they say in this argument is that the legislative system can't pass stuff. In Appeal Why, I told you that three examples of stuff that legislative systems have passed that have been very, very good for rights. I told you civil rights, I told you child labor laws, I told you food safety laws. There's a vast majority of changes that can be passed legislatively. And so this doesn't seem to be true. But moreover, they seem to think that furthermore, that you must be able to change the government really, really quickly. Their answer to this is essentially, their analysis on this is essentially the only way to show people's power is by like protesting in the street. Of course, that's not true in democratic systems where you can vote. The only thing that they said in response to this is in countries like Greece, Spain, Italy, and Ukraine, where the political system is inherently bad, then protesting is the only way to change the system. Of course, they've listed four examples of where peaceful protest has not changed the system, and in fact made it far, far worse. For example, Ukraine is currently still racked by civil war. People are being killed as we speak. In Greece, Alexis Tsipras, who's leading the CDSPY, is unable to make lasting change. He is being blocked by the Troika, by the EU. And the same thing is happening in Spain. Podemos hasn't even won any controlling elections. It doesn't seem like in any of the examples that they are saying this is that anything that they're saying is true. Furthermore, they're completely idealistic on this point. People cannot control what politicians do if the system itself is flawed, even under their system, even under CDSPY. You know, Greece has a 25% unemployment rate, and it's still rising. Spain is similar, and Italy has 4.5%. I don't know why they think these are success stories. So the third point that I'm giving you today, I'm going to give you a lot of analysis on better ways to create change. Now, in answer to the point about this dictatorship, firstly, remember, this isn't a debate confined to dictatorship. They have to prove that it's better in all cases. But moreover, their examples in this debate are cherry-picked. What you have to remember is that in the majority of cases, we think that the reaction that dictators have to this protest is often far, far worse. Here's a few layers of analysis on this. On the backlash, we told you in our first speech example of Bahrain, on how people's ideas die when they put their bodies at risk, and it's how it's far, far better to protest through legitimate political systems. They have a couple examples, high-profile examples of where this is worth. We're here to tell you that the lives lost, the ideas lost, that could have created vastly more concerns in other ways, are far, far more harmful than a couple success stories. Moreover, the second layer of analysis is that this disables basic services. They seem to think that's good. We think the effects of this are incredibly bad. Yeah, look at Syria, look at Libya, look at Egypt, look at Tunisia. All examples of the Arab Spring, which we think was so good. All of them are perfect examples of the trend that we're talking about, that peaceful protest leads to violent protest, leads to failed regime change, and leads to shambles afterwards.
Sir.
Millions of deaths have been caused by the examples that we think are so good. Millions of refugees have had to leave their homes because of the protests that they are supporting. If you support that, that's absolutely awful. It's the worst thing. They're giving you the worst examples of what can come out of protests. Those lives did not need to be or deserve to be lost.
Yep.
Yes, because ISIS in Syria is street power.
ISIS in Syria is not street power. The Syrian revolution, rooted in history, comes from peaceful protest. Two people were killed in a Syrian city, resulting in peaceful protest, which then turned violent after they were co-opted by extremist groups, and then that's how the revolution started. They seem to not know their history, Judge. Now, let's move on to their third argument, which is that people have the right to peaceful protest. We think that if this protest is like legitimate under democratic ideals, then it's not what their definition of protest is, which is like severely impairing like democracy. So it can't really be included under the definition anyway. But moreover, to give you examples of how peaceful protest is pragmatically bad. Why does this conflict with their rights? We think that you feeling good about what you're doing creates harmful impacts, then you cannot separate the two. There's a fundamentally incorrect Western conception that pragmatics and philosophy are separate from each other. The truth is that they're inextricably linked. You cannot have one without the other. If their morality results in millions of people dying in the Arab Spring, then you should reject their morality, Judge. This point doesn't matter.
Sir.
Now, let's go on to what are rights. We think that there are inherent moral problems with street power. We think that the goals of political change are undermined and destroyed by this policy. Their answers to this have been completely, they bond you with examples. And until you get like some real analysis from them, for why these points are not true, then you should just accept our logic. Here's the impact of this. We think that our first point, that there are inherent moral problems with street powers, that they're easily destroyed, that they fail to create long-lasting change, those mean that the pragmatic effects of change will not happen. Then on the second point, we think that the goals of political change are undermined and distorted, which means that the political change itself is going to be destroyed from the inside out. That's the stuff that they have not answered. Now onto our third point, that this destroys existing change. We think that a majority of effective loss of long-lasting change happens through legislature, through gradual political change, not through revolution and street power. And we think that by overshadowing and dismantling moderate support for political change, street power ends up being incredibly harmful to the goals of political change. What is the legislative power that we support? We think that people have much more powerful tools to change things. We think they have voting, we think they have monetary and political support, we think they have speech, we think that they can create large societal movements without actually having to engage in street power, and we think that this is far better, because legislative change tends to last a long time. I'm going to list a bunch of reasons why. Legislative change tends to last a long time. Civil rights laws have been created by this. Food safety laws, child labor laws, most of the rights you enjoy have been created through legitimate legislative political systems. And they have lasted for a long, long time because of it. Moreover, it results in more international support. Organizations like Amnesty International in the United States can have really, really incredible contributions to the political system, but they cannot intervene and help if street power is used, because it takes away legitimacy, it looks like a law, it often turns violent, and it stops economic progress, so they're not willing to support it. Moreover, legislative change avoids all the problems listed in our second argument, and legislative change tends to be more moderate, more representative of what the people think, because revolutionary change is co-opted by extremist groups. And we think that the right reform is going to be enacted when legislative change happens, when voting happens, because everybody's voices are taken into account. What is the impact of this? We think that the political change that we all want is stifled by their plan. We think that it's far, far better if you're going to choose between the two, legislative legitimate change and their radical political change, that you should choose the one that saves more lives, that results in a more pragmatic benefit because it is more likely to create change. And they have not answered these fundamental arguments. You should vote for those.
the democratic system, which is good and beautiful, cannot solve problems that exist. Sometimes in authoritarian regimes, we have no other means than violence. And for that reason, we support street power. So I will start this speech firstly by, through the first clash, I will rebuttal their third argument, and I will show you why do we have this need for protests and why they're so effective in today's society. The second clash is about violence, whether it is needed and whether it can be good in certain circumstances. So let me start by this rebuttal and first clash. We believe that sometimes need for protesting exists exactly because the system doesn't work. Just because democracy is in its basis a good system which should be able to control itself within the government and so on, we don't see that always happen. First, about the voting. Voting is every 4 or 5 years, depending on the country. But sometimes the government can, through this time, do a bad work. And because of that reason, we need to have the opportunity to protest and to do something instantly. We saw this strong example of Italy and so on. Secondly, we believe that movements that they are talking about are exactly, most of the time, protesting movements. For example, we see the move for rights of African Americans. Those were protests. Secondly, we see the movements from women's rights. And also goes on our side, because this is exactly an example of protests and street power. We see that sometimes the system has no ability to control itself, because it unfortunately it gets corrupted. We have the example of Austria and Croatia, for example, where our part of their prime minister had a deal with banks. So we see that took a lot of money from the state's budget and took bribe. So we see that in those cases, we don't have the system of democracy that works. Secondly, we have lobbying as a big issue, because companies can, in a large amount, influence the policies of the government. Let's take the example of California and GMO labeling, where for the $1 of people who were for the labeling, we had $28 for the ones who were against, from the big firms. So we see that they have a big leverage to this point. We see that system is slow, and therefore we need the ability to change it very fastly, and we cannot change it to this governmental and voting ways. So we see that, we believe that those are bigger problems than the consequences we have, and are telling us that are problematic. For example, if we don't have a transfer in the city for a few days because we want to change that our government doesn't sell something which is so important for us, then that's not a bigger harm. Secondly, we believe that if university doesn't work for a few days, it's a less hurting students less than the consequences if we made our educational system worse. Also, they are saying that we are stopping economical growth by this. But let's take a look of Orange Revolution, where after solving these corruption problems, Ukraine finally got a big economical growth. So through this, we see that it's a good way. So why is it solving the problem? Firstly, because it's giving awareness. If we don't solve it immediately, still we make people think about it, and maybe they'll change their ways on voting. So we made this where other ways aren't so seeable in media, in public, and we believe that's something that's very important in democratic system. Secondly, we see that state then sees that something is a big problem for the people. Even state can sometimes not be aware of something being a problem for people. So we believe that that's, again, a way of pressuring state to do something and so on. So even if we don't change, completely our ways, at least in democracy we decided what is better for us and what do we want as a way for our state to be. Secondly, let's let's look on this point of violence. We believe that nobody, well, in autocratic regimes, we have nobody to turn to. Military, state, military and police, they are working for the state. Secondly, we see that there is no other way to do it. It's because dictators and so on just won't leave their place by themselves. Of course, if you have a maximum power of your state, that's something that people won't give up. And so we believe that even if this causes a certain destruction in the country, it still means that we had certain opportunity for bases to start all over. Because if we didn't have a certain protest, a certain revolution, we would never change our ways if we waited for the system to solve itself. Because it won't, please.
In Syria, the people actually had the international community to turn to until they turned violent and the international community withdrew the majority of their support.
International community, unfortunately, most of the time isn't a really useful way. We see that most of them are just, for example, they are just sitting in the UN, having certain agreements, thinking that something is problematic, but not actually doing something. People in Ukraine are, for example, now dying, and in the UN we have certain, we had for a long time discussions, will we do it like this, will we do it like that, and we need to do it immediately, we need to do it now. So also, we believe that if somebody in autocratic regimes, they oppress you. We see, for example, of Poland, they actually make military to go on people who were protesting for their rights and against communism. So we see if your state attacks you, then we believe that you have the right to respond violently, because that's actually the only way you can respond to such oppression. So what side proposition showed you today is firstly that unfortunately we don't live in utopia, we don't live in systems that are perfect, and so because systems cannot solve their problems by themselves, by the means we have in the system, we need to have ability to protest, ability to have big movements which can change our ways, which can at least make the basis that one day we can achieve the change. Therefore, we beg you to propose the motion.
Legislative and voting procedure in order to make lasting and political change. Ultimately, they have to prove in the majority of cases and not just list examples in order to win this debate. Three questions in this speech. Firstly, what is best for the cause that is being protested? Second, what is best for the countries that these protests occur in? And finally, what is best for the people? But firstly, on the question of what is best for these causes, political change, as I said, is key to any well-functioning government. But public demonstrations and protests don't help this cause. If anything, they hurt the cause. But firstly, look to the examples they give you of peaceful protests. We give you key analysis based on the example of Bahrain. In Bahrain, peaceful protests failed every single time. They were squashed by the government, and it proved the fact that peaceful protests rarely, if ever, work. But then they cite examples in support of this. They give you the analysis based on Ukraine, Spain, and Greece. But my second speaker already refuted all of this. In terms of Ukraine, they're currently in a civil war. In terms of Greece, all of their legislation is being blocked by the international community. And in terms of Spain, Podemos isn't even gaining any power within the country. All these examples that they cite of peaceful protests leading to actual success aren't actually arguments for it, but actually arguments for why the country is worse off after these protests. So then, look to the examples they gave you of Yugoslavia and Macedonia, where they tell you that education systems were shut down because of these protests. If anything, this isn't a benefit for their side in the debate, but this is a clear harm. When people suffer because systems are shut down simply because of a protest, and the country is worse off afterwards, it's a clear harm to everyone. People suffer for nothing. But even if some lasting change comes after these protests and after these shutdowns, it's still not worth the harm that happened in that interim.
Sir.
But then, they give the examples of violent protests at that point. And peaceful protests, more often than not, will devolve into violent protests. When people find out that a peaceful approach isn't working, they more often than not turn to violence. But even in cases where violence starts first, it's a clear harm. Look to the examples we give you of the Arab Spring. The Arab Spring was an instance in which peaceful protests turned violent, and then the whole area collapsed because of a failure to comply. But then we also tell you that the international community condemned the Arab Spring after these violent protests turned to human rights abuses. Violent protests don't operate within any guidelines. They don't function in a way that's beneficial to the cause, and ultimately end up hurting everyone in the long run. The international community pulled out their support, and that was a huge harm. But then they give you this analysis that there's no other means of helping people in these regimes. And that's patently false. Look to the example of Romania, for example. Political assassinations was a key means through which people could reach lasting change in these authoritarian regimes. It's better than, on the whole, violence, because only one person died, and there isn't a whole conflict in the area. No, thank you, I've lost the answer. Political assassination is a viable technique, so when they tell you that there's no other alternatives in the area, that's simply
sir.
But then, we give the alternatives of social media and voting and civil disobedience. These are all better means through which you can reach a lasting resolution. Unlike simply protesting, these operate within the system that's been given to us. You can vote in a legislature. You can peacefully put out your opinion on social media, and you can use these other means to reach lasting change without the backlash that comes from protests.
Sir.
But ultimately, the final analysis they give you on helping the cause is that people will think about this issue. Even if nothing succeeds, at least it's in the public eye. But if anything, this functions as a harm to side proposition. Everyone's thinking about these issues, but in a bad way. Everyone understands now that because all these people are committing human rights abuses and violent protests, because people are being squashed in peaceful protests, that these causes aren't even worth fighting for. If anything, they're taking away from other things. But the second question we need to ask in today's debate is what is best for the country? Firstly, look to the fact that checks and balances empirically have worked in the past. We've touched on this a lot, but let's really explain it. We give you analysis that voting is a comprehensive means of reaching a good resolution. The example of GMOs, we tell you that it was reached through a legislature. But then look to the fact that civil disobedience is just as powerful. As opposed to simply getting out there and protesting, either violently or peacefully, civil disobedience is an accurate means. But then, look to the definition they gave you at the very beginning of this debate. They say that the street power needs to be a dramatic and public demonstration meant to drastically change the government. Firstly, they don't comply with this in terms of peaceful protest, but even if you believe that they do, peaceful protest and civil disobedience isn't as effective as voting. But then, we give you the analysis on authoritarian regimes. Essentially, they say that there's no way in an authoritarian regime to reach a conclusion without this supreme power. But then we respond to that with a key example of political assassinations, which are a better way of losing less lives in the area. No, thank you. But then, understand that legislative change works, and legislative change happens in the long run. Essentially, it works better in the majority of cases. When you can comply with the system that's currently in place and then reach change, people are more likely to accept that change. But even in cases where legislative change doesn't work, it's not worth turning to protest to reach a resolution. Because ultimately, that resolution isn't going to be favorable. Look to the Arab Spring again. When we turned to violent protest and destroyed regimes in the area, there was nothing left of the countries after them. And because there was no government in place, no way of running these countries, and essentially no way for people to survive in the areas, these violent protests left the regions far worse off than they were before. So even in cases where we can use legislative solutions, it's not worth turning to these other things, because at the end of the day, those are just pyrrhic victories. Ultimately, immediate change is not possible, and it's not effective. They say we need immediate change, but we can't get immediate change through protests, because that change is not only ineffective, but also actually harmful to the causes that they're ultimately trying to support. When we look at what's best for the country, it's when they comply with what's already in place. When they work with the systems that they've already been given, rather than losing the support of the international community and hurting the people within the country itself. But the final and really summary question we need to ask is what's best for the people? Ultimately, international backlash, harming the people, and all things that happen when you choose protest over actually voting and using the legislative process is not what's best for the people. Inside the proposition's world, we would forsake a legitimate legislative solution for a violent or peaceful protest that ultimately makes the cause worse off than it was before all these protests. Ultimately, we don't live in a perfect world. We don't live in a utopia. But it's because we understand these considerations that we need to work with the world that we get. Instead of irrationally trying to protest, and irrationally trying to stray through street power. Ultimately, that's why I'm so honored to oppose today's motion.
Except for like one city block that's controlled by the government.
And look at Syria, where there's still death happening in droves. Don't be fooled because they list a ton of stuff. They haven't actually made any examples that prove their point. In fact, most of them contradict it. Now, let's go on to the first thing that they say, which is that voting is too slow. Why do they jump to a revolution from this point? Okay, so it takes 5 years between when you can vote for your next a political leader. Then just make terms short. That's nothing to do with this topic. And they haven't shown you that the systematic problems of government can be solved through change. Look at the examples of systematic change that they cited. Greece, where the banks are still run by cronies. Greece, where the political leader, Alexis Tsipras, is making it so that Greece is unable to negotiate with the European Monetary Union. Where Tsipras is making it so that there's a good chance Greece is going to be the first country that's kicked out of the Eurozone. This is the kind of political change that happens with their plan, the kind that results in counterproductivity, the kind that results in danger, the kind that's not going to be effective. And look at what we've told you on this. We told you that there's inherent problems, that it's easily quashed, that there's no long-lasting messages. We told you that the goals of political change are undermined, that these are disjointed movements that don't actually garner popular support, that don't garner international support, that end up being co-opted by extremist groups. You can see that all throughout the Arab Spring. And we told you that legislative change is far more effective, that it results in more moderate movements that represent the population, that is long-lasting, that it avoids all the problems of street power that we talked about, that it tends to be a more representative of the people, and that all of those things are meaningful. You have to look at this on balance. Yeah, we provide slightly slower change. There's actually no way of getting around that. But our change is more meaningful. Our change is more long-lasting. Our change does not cost millions of lives. Again, don't be fooled by their examples. Have they proven to you that in 51% of cases that this is the right thing to do? Then if they haven't done that, they haven't won this motion. This motion is on balance. And if they haven't done that, then they don't deserve to win. And they haven't. Under Suthep Thassanam's rule in Thailand, peaceful protest was quashed. Thousands of people were killed. And meaningful change was stopped for equality for women and for equality for the black genders of Thailand. That is a perfect example of why they deserve to lose. They cause carnage and they cause the destruction of movements. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Nicholas. And now last but not least, we have been to
side proposition do not stand for vandalism. We do not stand for people fighting the police and destroying government buildings simply because it's fun. We'd like to work with the system, but it's impossible to work with the system when the system does not work with us. Because how do you work with a system that is inherently corrupt? How do you work with prime ministers who take bribes from banks and whom you cannot wait to depose in elections after 3 years because of this might do so much harm that your country will lay in economic ruin? How do you work with systems that they themselves mention, such as Bahrain, such as Thailand? How do you work with systems that are obviously prepared to use full-fledged violence against their citizens the moment they demand something? You do not work with these systems, because it is not only true that these systems do not work with you, these systems openly work against you, Mr. Speaker. And then you have the legitimate right to work against them. Risking your life in the process, perhaps, but doing so willingly and creating a long-lasting change. We accept the fact that in most authoritarian regimes, after violent protests and revolutions, things are in shambles, because that's what tends to happen when you depose an authoritarian regime. It's not that there's an authoritarian regime, we revolt and all of a sudden golden towers will start sprouting around us. Of course, things are in ruins, but from these ruins we will rise. From these ruins we will build. Now we have buildings, now we have cities and we have systems, but systems that will continue to oppress us. Your system sustains, but what does it sustain? It sustains a world where things do not change because governments do not react. We support ruins if from these ruins can rise a new world. And we have no problem with that because this new world that we rebuild it will react to the will of the citizens and it will have no reason for street power anymore. They accuse us of not knowing our history. We invite them to look around the globe. Greece is another example. with this. Yeah, sure, in Greece and Spain change has not already happened. But the situation in Greece and Spain is not a result of street protests. Rather, street protests are a result of the fact that change has not been happening. Greece and Spain will perhaps have change in 2 or 3 years, but this possibility of change would never have been brought about if it were not for street protests. Ukraine, today's civil war has nothing to do with the Orange Revolution, but what has to do with the Orange Revolution is economic growth that happened after Yushchev. Hungary, a semi-oppressive regime, where one of the main freedoms that you stand for, the freedom of speech, the freedom to use this very social media to advocate as a means, was protected by street power. Street power protected those freedoms you call upon. In France, today France holds its natural resources. Today Macedonia did not decide to put their entire university system under control of a state like in communism at the cost of what? A month of university not working? We're prepared to accept that cost, because education is supposed to last a lifetime. A shutdown lasts 2 months, and we look on the long term, Mr. Speaker. Yugoslavian countries on the long term gained the right to freedom because of peaceful protests. Women and African Americans, you know how they gained their rights? Through a legislature in the end. But what did drive this legislature? Protest, as I told you in my speech. And this is not a cause that loses legitimacy. This is a cause that gained legitimacy. This is a cause we all believe in, and we believe in this cause because it was a ripple effect caused by protests, people on the streets. In the end, on balance, they have not shown us that there exists an alternative in all cases. And in these cases, where this alternative does not exist, there is no other choice but to accept the harms, and through accepting these harms, build a system where an alternative will exist. They have not shown us there is an alternative in all authoritarian regimes. They have not shown us that in a precarious economic situation, the legislature is quick enough to drive change. We've given you a lot of examples where actually change has led to some long-term benefit, like for example in Macedonia, in Hungary, in France, and in the world. We support building from ruins, we support building from violence, even if it means staying in the ground with blood. Thank you very much.